All right.
So, how you been? You're in Gothenburg now, are you?
It's great. I mean, finally the sun is coming along. You know, we have really, really harsh winters over here. So it's been minus 10 all over Christmas, and now we're getting some hope for the spring.
Yeah.
It's the other way around from you guys.
We are actually 40 degrees Celsius 5 days in a row. Man, that's wow. Let's just exchange 20 degrees. I think I'll be happy with that, my friend, you know. So Gothenburg, that's a very nice place, I would imagine, you know, cool and nice. So we are here to talk about your debut album, Out of This World, self-titled as well. And it happened to be the same title as the fourth album of Europe.
Yeah.
How did that happen?
That was obviously a plan, or the original plan was to find a band name that would enhance the recognition, you know, for people who know my music, but maybe not necessarily know this new band. So instead of choosing a very anonymous, cool new band name, you know, we had different suggestions on the table. My publicist in Britain suggested I would call it, she was adamant I should call it Key Marcellus Europe. And I said, that's a completely ridiculous idea. I hate when bands do that. You know, I remember in the mid 80s, there were like three, The Suite. Do you remember The Suite?
Yep.
Ballroom Blitz and all those, you know.
Yep.
Three different versions of this band was touring in UK simultaneously. It's very confusing for the fans. And we have that still today. I mean, if you remember Yes, Owner of a Lonely Heart, there's two versions of Yes. There's two versions of Saxon. Yep. There's a lot of examples of that. So I didn't want to do that. Plus, I'm not Europe. I have no wish to be Europe. I have to be the only thing I want to do is do my productions, my music, my songwriting. So in the midst of all this, we had a lot of really bad names on the table. Then a Japanese friend of Tommy Hart, the singer's, called him and said, why don't you call the band Out of This World? One, it's the album that really broke key in Japan for us Japanese fans, you know? And it wouldn't be that much different than when Ronnie James Dio was singing in Black Sabbath.
Mm.
And for obvious reasons, they couldn't call it Black Sabbath. I mean, one, Sharon Osbourne would have sued their asses into smithereens. So that wouldn't have worked at all. So they called it Heaven and Hell from the album they did. But it's Black Sabbath with Ron James Dio singing. So I'm thinking, man, this is something similar. Obviously not the same thing, but it's a similar thing. So, and the name grew on us as we worked with the album. So Out of This World it is.
Cool. It's a very cool name, man. It also feels like this band is like a super group, isn't it? I mean, you've got Tommy Hart from a legendary German band. You've got you from Europe. That's one of my favorite bands now. Then you got the drummer from Gary Moore and Darkness, who I saw just before the lockdown in Perth. I'm from Perth, Australia, by the way. And then you got Ken from Aliens. I've not heard of Alien, but I'm sure it's a really good band. So it feels like your band really gelled together really well. You guys have been together for 50 years or 40 years. Is it because of the individual members are being so professional, or is it because you guys have played together for before this at all? Or?
Well, first of all, Ken is a good friend and bass player. We both live in Gothenburg, and we played together for, oh man, the beginning of the millennia, 2003 or 2004 or something, and almost constantly since then. And so we're like brothers in arms. And Darby has been in Key Marcello band for a while as well. He's a great drummer. You mentioned Gary Moore and Rob Plant and The Darkness, which are all great. And also Devin Townsend, which is another bands and acts in that, you know, really technical genre as well. And he met, we did hundreds of shows, not only with Kim Marcello Band, but with my show Rock the Night, where we do kind of all kinds of music. And so we've really shared and paid a dues on stage, you know, which means also playing around on sound check and getting to know each other musically. And he does not only do metal and hard rock, he plays unbelievable fusion and jazz and, I mean, anything. He's got such a spectrum. It's really an honor to work with musicians like that because everything comes easy. But if I have an idea in a song and I want the verse to be a bit calmer, almost like soul, Sam Cooke. And he goes, okay, Sam Cooke, check. He knows that shit. And if you want something, I want some, you know, some old school heavy metal hair, like Double Cakes, but, you know, not the really super fast modern stuff, but old school heavy metal. Then he can do that. He just knows so much about music. It's awesome. And the same goes for both Ken and Tommy. When you have a group of musicians like this with such a variety and knowledge, an impressive knowledge about music and music history, it's really easy to create stuff together, you know. So I'm very proud of the band and this album. And it didn't hurt to have the amazing Don Airey on four tracks.
So I guess the flavor of this album, it's more of a melodic rock, isn't it? So is that a natural, I guess, progression given the history, the background of the individual members of each? Is that the natural progression, or did you guys discuss about it before this or not?
Absolutely. I mean, that's what we all love, and that's what we're made of. And like I said, like you can imagine, I've been doing 1,000 interviews for this release. And I mean, I never tried to do anything that I'm not. I never tried to do death metal or anything else because I wouldn't do anything good. So I stuck to my guns, and I've been writing pretty much the same song since 1982, you know, in different versions, and it keeps evolving, and that's what I want to do. I like the marriage between heaven and hell, which is guitars and keyboards, you know, and I use the keyboards when I compose constantly. It's pretty much the same thing I've been doing since the early 80s, you know, I can't see why I would change that. Plus, I really love strong songs, you know, with choruses and verses and bridges and twists that makes you want to listen more. I hate plain stuff. I hear a lot of plain stuff, I have to say. Here's the verse, okay, here's the mid-8, here's the chorus. It's like this, it's so predictable. I hate predictable in songwriting, you know. And plus, it has to be melodic. You know, I can't just write songs that riffs away for 2 hours. It's not me. So I think I'm doing exactly what I want to do. And the other guys, we all share the same love for this genre. People call it AOR. That title, I think. I mean, the name of the genre, it sucks. I mean, album-oriented. I mean, come on. What does that even mean? Do we have albums anymore? I mean, I think it's just rock and roll. We're playing rock and roll, as simple as that.
Yeah, true.
And very melodic rock and roll.
Very. And you guys are really, I mean, you spoke about Japan earlier on, but you guys are really quite successful in Japan, isn't it?
Yes. I mean, everything, it's been like a auto piano, you know, like a self-playing piano from the get-go, where we first started off with a crowdfunding thing, you know. We wanted to set, you know, like it's pretty popular nowadays. You set up a crowdfunding thing and the fans can buy the products before they're out there. And we did that, but as soon as we put that out online, we got a lot of offers from, namely Japan. So what happened was sort of a a bidding competition for a while there in Japan, and we decided to go with JBC Victor since, well, I've been there with I was there with Europe.
Yep.
They did a great job with Europe, and I had other projects there. I produced a project and I wrote some stuff. Always had good experiences with JBC Victor. So we went with them and did an amazing job. We went almost immediately to top 10, and we were number one on the album charts with the album. So it's going really good in Japan. We're really happy to say so. And then for the rest of the world, we wanted to wait because we heard about this new label in the makings. The guy who was the founding character of Nuclear Blast.
Yeah.
He's coming up with a new label. And we thought that sounds like that would hit us, that would fit us perfectly, because we need somebody who knows the style of music and can relate to that. I mean, if you're gonna sign with a major label these days, they only sell pop. Mm. If you think about it, major labels have forgotten how to sell melodic rock. Since the 90s, they didn't know how to do it anymore. So the replies you get when you come to a major label is very often, "Oh, it's really hard to sell this music." Well, it's not if you do your job.
Yeah. So speaking of singles, Hanging On, that is, I think that is your first release from the album.
Yeah.
You have lyrics like, "Why do you keep me hanging on?" So it's a song about longing, desperation, and relationship, right? It feels like it's been written by a love-struck teenager, you know? So did that happen to you in the last 2 or 3 years, mate?
No, I can't. So, I mean, it definitely, I mean, we've all been there, you know, yeah. Having the feeling that you like the counterpart a bit more than vice versa. And you wonder why you keep me hanging on here if you don't really want me. Just keeping me like a teddy bear or something. It's a really interesting concept. I've been happily married for 22 years. So I haven't been there for a while. But I think it's something everybody can relate to. You know, it doesn't even have to be love. I mean, you can have, you commercially end up in a situation where you feel like you're like the third wheel. What am I doing here? You pay me for my job, but what do I really do? And it comes with an identity crisis, I think, and that's what the song is about, you know.
Yeah. A Million Years, the next song, which is one of my first two. We got lyrics like, "Will there be lovers in a million years from now?" I mean, what's the key message behind the song? You know, your interpretation of the song, basically.
Well, the thing is, quite a lot of my lyrics are about either the end of the world or what's going to happen next, you know. And this is one of those, how will we look like in a million years? Are we even here, you know? And if there would be lovers in a million years, what would that be like? You know, will they feel this? Will they experience the same problems we have now, or have we gone to a different stage, or, you know, what's happening? It's just an interesting, it's an interesting play with that song, so to speak. And it's a song.
Cool. So it did not, I guess, transpire from anything to do with perhaps mental illness. It's just, you know, you guys just wrote it because it is a good song anyway, right? Yeah,
the song was originally written for Europe, for the Prisoners in Paradise album, but it never made it. I have a demo from that old time, which I picked up again, which is from 1990, I guess, you know. And remember our manager, Europe's manager back then, who also was managing Journey, he passed away a month ago, where he said, Herbie Herbert. He loved the song. because he liked the idea of you know, looking into the future, what's going to happen with the planet, with us, with, you know, who's here in a million years. It's an interesting concept.
Yeah. I mean, we touched base about Europe, so this interview wouldn't be complete if I didn't talk about Europe. So if you don't mind me asking, how was it like to be a critical band member in one, well, to be a member in one of the biggest, hottest bands, you know, in the world? How was it like, I wonder?
It was really amazing in many ways. I mean, of course, you remember the craziness when everything broke, completely exploded. And the thing is, when I joined the band weren't really big in any territories except Sweden and Japan, a little bit in Japan. Major in Sweden, obviously, but you also have to remember back then, it was really hard for a Swedish hard rock act to penetrate the rest of the world, because nobody really took Scandinavian rock seriously, with a few exceptions, like Easy Action, my band before Europe, and Hanoi Rocks, who got a little bit of the piece. But I mean, it's very telling that Easy Action, my band, in 1983, was the first rock band ever from Sweden to sign an American major label deal. We signed with Warner, and it was like on the first page on both newspapers. It was such a big deal because it never happened before. Nobody signed with a U.S. major label deal, and this is still 1986, But when I joined the band in October 1986, then it starts to pop up a little bit all over Europe. It started in Holland, I think. And then it was one country after another where the Final Countdown started to pop up on the charts. Eventually, it was like number one in 26 countries, which is crazy. But when that happened, I don't think any one of us in the band were prepared for that. How could you? It happens very rarely. And the way we realized it was that it was getting increasingly difficult to play live or even show ourselves in public because there were people everywhere. I remember coming to Japan. We had no idea what to expect. We were there to do a promotion. And then this guy came and said, we have a big problem. Many people, and we were like, what's the problem with that? That's why we do this shit. We love, wow, it's great. How many are there? And we're like 5,000-10,000 people. Sounds great. It's more than we get to our gigs. That's amazing. And then when we got out there, we realized what they meant. It was fucking dangerous, you know, to get through the crowd. And we had loads of bodyguards trying to keep the people, you know, from pulling our arms off, basically. And we went into the cars, into the limousines. And I remember going into the limousines, and there were people on top of the cars, under the cars, you know, just surrounding us. And I was thinking constantly, Beatles documentary, because that was the only thing I could relate to that I've ever seen that reminded me of this, you know. And that's when it got really crazy. And it continued to be that when we were the biggest band in the world in 1987 and 88, we would go on tour and suddenly not being able to leave the hotel because it was surrounded of 10, 20,000 fans. They were, you know, they were doing campfires in the parks, playing, keeping all the hotel guests awake, you know, with playing Europe songs on the acoustic guitar and all that. It was chaos everywhere we went. And that's something you never forget. Crazy.
Yeah, true.
But I think it didn't drive us crazy was that we got to experience it together. Because Europe was never that big before the break of the Final Countdown, which was when I was in the band. Another thing we did we always did runners after the last encore on stage. The tour manager had our ropes, so we just jumped off stage, put a robe on, in out the back door into the limo scenes, and just fucked out of there. Because if we didn't, and we learned this the hard way, we were kept hostage in the venues for hours,
wow,
sometimes a whole night, because they wouldn't go anywhere. They would know we're in there, and they would wait for us, you know, camp if necessary. So we just had to do runners for our own health, basically. We needed sleep and, you know, get back to the hotel. And also we had to use secret names. I remember my name was K-Man. K-M-A-N-N.
Aww.
You know, yeah, it's actually an existing name, Man. It's a Nordic, I guess, you know. I remember Joey's name was Thompson, Mr. Thompson. And this was obvious because the hotel security was, even if you were staying at the best hotels, which we were doing, the hotel security was not as good as it is right now. I mean, if you check into a hotel today, you need a key to even get into the elevator. It wasn't like that. Of course, they had guards and stuff, but the fans, the hardcore fans, would always figure out where we lived. You know, they would bribe somebody in the reception, you know, to get what room is he in here, and they could, and that happened a lot too. So we had to take measures to be able to live through this and without losing our minds.
But you were in your 20s back then, you know, growing up as a young man. I've seen documentaries about Europe, and it portrays them as this hedonistic lifestyle of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Is there much truth to that at all?
Yes and no. I mean, it really got out of hand when we came to LA. I mean, LA was crazy back in those days. And that's where the real sex, drugs, and rock and roll thing started. But I mean, it's a really weird lifestyle where those elements come quite naturally. That's why you see so many rock artists getting hooked on alcohol and drugs, because it's everywhere all the time. And it's like part of the whole deal. That's why they call it sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You know, it's like a phenomena, really wild. So I would never do, you know, often get the question, do you feel like you want to do that again, or do you wish you would have continued? And fuck no, I've done it. I think it's enough to have experienced it once in a lifetime. I couldn't live like that anymore, not being able to go to get groceries without being attacked.
So were you involved in the third album, the Final Countdown album, or were you actually recorded with in that album as well, or was it John Norum that was involved in the album?
Not at all. The first album I was on.
The third album, the Final Countdown album?
No. The first album I was on was Out of This World in 1988. So I joined in 1986 in October. So I did all the touring outside Sweden, you can say, for the Final Countdown World Tour. So I started off with the tour, which lasted for 1.5 years. So when it was time for the follow-up to the Final Countdown, that was the first album I really, studio album I played on, so to speak. We did some live videos and stuff for that tour, but that was the very first time I went in.
Yeah, it's quite interesting because John Norum actually left at, because from what I read, John actually left at the peak of Europe because he felt that the band was too commercialized, Pandex, Teeny Boppers. Yeah, it's interesting that he left at it's, you know, that's what I read anyway. But then you're telling me that you left just before Rishi's peak. So that's quite interesting, technically, yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, I don't think anybody knew how big it was going to get. Not even when he left either, you know. So nobody has a crystal ball.
I would regret it. So when can we see you in Perth, Australia? Will you come to Perth, Australia, as a current band out of this world, or do you think you'll come here as Europe if they still exist as a band? Yeah.
I won't play with Europe anymore. No, those days are over for me. But I would love to come to Australia with Out of This World. And as soon as this pandemic starts to calm down a little bit, which it shows signs of doing, actually. It feels like this Omicron is not as bad as they thought in the beginning. And if this continues, we could go on tour already this spring or summer. And a no-brainer would be going to Japan, since we were number one there. And being in Southeast Asia, it's not so far away from Oceania to go to Australia and Perth and whatnot. So I definitely hope we can do that run very soon.
Well, I hope so too. Well, if you do come to Perth, mate, let's have a beer, all right?
Absolutely. I promise you that.
Yeah. It's such a great honor to have a chat with you, mate. It feels like I'm talking to one of my favorite bands, and here am I talking to you. It's just a real night. Such a humble guy too, you know. Thank you so much, sir, and I will see you soon, all right?
See you in Perth, my friend.
Yeah, take it. Bye.
Bye.